This month, the Space and Missile Defense community made its annual pilgrimage to Huntsville, Alabama for the Space and Missile Defense Symposium, just shortly after President Joe Biden announced U.S. Space Command would remain in Colorado Springs, Colorado, rather than relocate to Huntsville, and amid Senator Tommy Tuberville's blanket hold on general and flag officer confirmations. The U.S. Space Command commander did not attend the event, and much of the typically information-packed speeches from high-ranking military officials were a bit stifled due to current roles. But there is still plenty happening as the U.S. continues to evolve its missile defense capability to meet emerging threats. One of the hotter topics at the show is the Missile Defense Agency's efforts, in conjunction with the services, to develop an architecture on Guam to defend the island from air and missile defense threats across the board. The MDA began to discuss clear plans for outfitting Guam with capability, along with a rough timeline. But discussions at the symposium provided more clarity and context on the way forward. I spoke with missile defense expert Tom Carrico at the Center for Strategic and International Studies directly following the symposium on his takeaways.
For me, though, I think probably the highlight was the number of people talking about the defense of Guam and things related to the defense of Guam. Again, back to your Army-centric observation there, perhaps not a surprise. It was, I think, June 20 when the department named the Army as the service acquisition executive. Build a plant in charge of the defense of Guam effort overall, but the Army is the lead service. And so you're going to see some officers or officials and officials being named to kind of go out and implement that, I think, here pretty soon.
Yes, yes. And I think pretty much in every speech that I attended, listened to, and the conversations that I had, Guam was brought up. I mean, it most of the things that the Army is developing right now will be a part of the Guam architecture. And I think there was quite a bit of discussion, at least on the first day, with some of the Army officials in charge of Program Executive Office Missiles in Space, General Lozano, particularly talking about integrated fires capability and conducting integrated fires test campaign that essentially is kicking off this year, later this fall, where they will begin to integrate various aspects of air and missile defense capabilities together in this test campaign, starting off small with the integrated battle command system and the lower tier air and missile defense sensor, LTAMDS. And those are all going to play a part in the Guam architecture. In subsequent years, they'll keep adding capability, but you know, they brought up so many different capabilities that we're going to see on Guam, from mid-range capability missiles, which have been fielded to the first unit. And so that's all aligning with the Guam architecture timelines of actually seeing an architecture, I think, by 2028 with fires, or 2027.
Well, there'll be capability there much sooner.
Beginning to next year.
And, you know, as we've seen in Ukraine, even a limited air defense goes a long way in terms of having a strategic effect. So there'll definitely be stuff there sooner.
The symposium also marked the first time Major General Heath Collins delivered a major update to an audience since being nominated to become the next MDA director. His confirmation is one of those being held by Senator Tuberville, so he was only able to speak from his current perch in charge of MDA's ground-based systems. Even so, he managed to highlight some important progress the agency is making to increase its capability to see emerging and less detectable threats.
The thing that stood out to me was the feature on space sensors. And so it's, you know, the hypersonic and ballistic tracking space sensor, HBTSS, is always in there. But there was a video, and it was a little.
It's usually a 30-second.
Yeah, I would say it was a foot stomp, and I think that was good, precisely because it's going to be some of the prototypes for that are going to be orbited later this year, pretty soon here in a couple months, and so I think that was. A good move to highlight that. And it's a good move, I think, in part because, you know, there will be a potential valley of death transition moment as those prototypes, that medium field of view sensor, is tested, demonstrated, and then in some way through a joint program office handed over to the Space Development Agency, SDA.
Exactly.
So that's I think, useful that it was highlighted in terms of its importance. It is the only fire control quality sensor that the department is pursuing.
The symposium also highlighted some major tests and other milestones coming soon that are vital to the development and continued strength of the global missile defense architecture, including an imminent offensive hypersonic glide body test critical for ultimately fielding the first hypersonic rounds to the Army by the end of this year, and the first major flight test for the Guam architecture expected by the end of 2024. And the Army also highlighted an important emerging issue surrounding engagement authorities for missile defense as threats change and capability increases.
There was an interesting conversation between us about engagement authorities and kind of how, in some respects, we're really living with a tightness in terms of the engagement authorities for air defenders that's really a function of learning the lesson of 2003 when there was that friendly fire incident in 2003. But we are in a very different world. We cannot take air superiority for granted in the way we kind of could in relative to a small country. So I would also kind of look for things like that. I think that as we come to grips with the reality of this massive air and missile threat that is the world right now, we're going to have not just lots of acquisition stuff, but operational changes as well.
Right.
For more on my coverage from the symposium, visit defensenews.com. I'm Jen Judson, Land Warfare Reporter, Defense News.